kính chào Hội Thánh. Hôm nay ngày Thánh Nhật chúng ta hân hoan ra mắt Chúa. Tôi có một câu Kinh Thánh xin đọc cho quý chúng ta suy gẫm. Câu Kinh Thánh được chép trong Thi Thiên 105 từ câu 1 tới câu 5. Hãy ca ngợi Đức Giê-hô-va và cầu khẩn danh Ngài. Hãy rao truyền công việc Ngài giữa các dân. Hãy hát cho Ngài, hãy ca ngợi Ngài, hãy suy gẫm tất cả những việc kỳ diệu của Ngài. Hãy tự hào trong danh thánh Ngài. Nguyện lòng của những người tìm kiếm Đức Giê-hô-va được hoan lạc. Hãy tìm kiếm Đức Giê-hô-va và quyền năng Ngài. Hãy tìm kiếm mặt Ngài luôn luôn. Hãy nhớ lại những việc kỳ diệu mà Ngài đã làm, các phép lạ và phán quyết từ miệng Ngài. Đó là lời Chúa được chép trong Thi Thiên 105. Xin Hội Thánh đứng lên hội ý với tôi dâng lời cầu nguyện. Kính lạy Cha, kính yêu chúng con. Chúng con hôm nay rất là hân hoan được ra mắt Chúa, được ra, được biết để chúng con được thờ phượng Ngài. Ôi Cha Thánh ơi, cầu xin Ngài ban phước cho chúng con được cảm nhận được tình yêu của Ngài luôn luôn. Và con biết Ngài là luôn quan phòng chúng con và hướng dẫn chúng con từng bước. Nguyện xin Đức Thánh Linh ở cùng với chúng con. Ngày hôm nay, chúng con có buổi lễ dâng lên Chúa. Nguyện xin Chúa đẹp lòng và hà hơi chúc phước cho những chương trình của chúng con dâng lên trên Ngài. Xin Ngài ban phước cho chúng con, ban hát thờ phượng, người hướng dẫn chương trình, người chia sẻ lời Chúa, được đẹp lòng Ngài luôn. Ôi Cha Thánh ơi, xin Ngài ở cùng với anh em chúng con đang trên đường tới đây. Nguyện xin Ngài ở cùng và ban phước cho chúng con được kịp lúc để chúng con thờ phượng Chúa. Xin ca Ngài mở lòng của chúng con để tiếp nhận lời Chúa. Và xin Ngài ban cho chúng con có thần linh của Ngài, có ơn của Chúa để làm được theo lời của Ngài. Chúng con tạ ơn Ngài vô cùng. Chúng con dâng lên Chúa là cầu nguyện này trong danh của Chúa Jesus Christ. Amen. Xin Hội Thánh cứ đứng, mời ban hát thờ phượng.
Sáng nay chúng ta vui mừng chúng ta đến nhà của Chúa với một tấm lòng trống không để chúng ta chứa đựng Chúa. Cảm ơn Chúa những gì mà Chúa đã làm cho chúng ta. Chúa đã chết, Chúa đã hy sinh và Chúa đã sống lại, ban linh năng quyền sự sống cho chúng ta. Sáng hôm nay chúng ta là vui mừng vì điều đó mà Chúa đã làm chúng ta bằng tình yêu của Ngài. Xin kính mời Hội Thánh cùng nhau đọc trong Galati đoạn 2 câu 20. Xin ta cùng đọc. Tôi đã bị đóng đinh vào thập tự giá với Đấng Christ mà tôi sống. Không phải là tôi sống nữa, nhưng Đấng Christ sống trong tôi. Hiện nay tôi sống trong thể xác, tức là tôi sống trong đức tin của con Đức Chúa Trời, là Đấng đã yêu tôi và phó chính mình Ngài vì tôi. Amen. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me.
And the life I now live in the flesh,
I live by the faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Amen.
Yeah.
Chúng tôi có một số thông báo. Xin quý vị gọi vào để chúng ta cùng nhau cầu nguyện cho sự phấn hưng của hội thánh của chúng ta. Vào ngày thứ hai tối, thứ hai sáng 7 giờ sáng và 9 giờ tối thứ hai và thứ năm, chúng ta cũng có hội thánh hưng 7 giờ sáng và 9 giờ sáng. Thứ ba thì chúng ta có cầu nguyện tuần hoàn tại nhà của anh Luân. Thứ năm thì chúng ta có chứng đạo, quý vị gọi vào để chúng ta cùng nhau đi lúc 12 giờ trưa. Thứ sáu thì chúng ta có nhóm thanh niên lúc 7 giờ tại nhà của anh Kurt. Và 8:30 thì chúng ta có học kinh thánh ở trên Zoom.
Zoom Bible study. 7:00 is.
Xin quý vị, chúng ta có website
youth group meeting
là tin lành florida.org. Mời quý vị vào trong những website này, thì chúng ta càng vào lớp website này thì chúng ta sẽ có mọi người search về tin lành thì sẽ thấy cái hội thánh của chúng ta. Chúng ta cũng có trại gia đình nguồn phước ngày 25, 26 tháng 5. Diễn giả là ông mục sư Phan Vĩnh Cử, hội phó của hội thánh tin lành miền Nam. Và chúng ta có hội đồng giáo hạt ngày thứ 49
district conference
tại Pomona, California. Xin quý vị ghi danh với mục sư Phiên. Bây giờ chúng ta sẽ tiếp tục thờ phượng Chúa qua phần dâng hiến. Xin quý vị hiệp ý với tôi dâng lời cầu nguyện.
Please come with me to the Lord in prayer.
Kính lạy Cha, kính yêu chúng con.
Heavenly Father.
Tạ ơn Chúa đã biệt riêng chúng con ra để chúng con được thờ phượng Chúa, là qua lo công việc nhà Ngài. Thưa Cha Thánh, buổi sáng hôm nay chúng con dâng lên Chúa tấm lòng để đáp lại lời kêu gọi của Ngài. Nguyện xin Chúa hạ hơi chúc phước những tài vật mà chúng con dâng lên buổi sáng hôm nay để nhà Chúa được phát triển và những công việc lời của Chúa được đồn ra một cách dễ dàng cho từ vùng chúng con đang ở đây và khắp nơi trên thế giới qua sự dâng hiến của chúng con. Nguyện xin Chúa chúc phước cho những tấm lòng của chúng con. Chúng con tạ ơn Ngài. Chúng con dâng lên Chúa lời cầu nguyện này trong danh của Chúa Jesus Christ. Amen. Chúng ta vẫn tiếp tục dùng hàng giữa để dâng hiến và dùng hai bên để trở về. Chúng ta khởi sự. Xin con cái Chúa, chúng ta dọn lòng để chúng ta dự tiệc thánh. Xin kính mời mục sư Nguyễn Thanh Phiên chủ lễ.
Xin kính mời hai vị trong ban tiệc thánh vui lòng tiến lên để có thể giúp tôi trong vấn đề phân phối tiệc thánh. Tiệc thánh là do Chúa chúng ta thiết lập trong đêm ngày bị nộp, và tiệc thánh dành cho tất cả những ai nhân cậy nơi công ơn cứu rỗi của Chúa Giêsu để được giải hòa với Đức Chúa Trời. Chúng ta là những người của giao ước thánh, giao ước mới mà Chúa Giêsu đã lập cho chúng ta qua huyết của Ngài. Cho nên nếu quý vị là những người đã đặt đức tin ở nơi Chúa Giêsu Christ, tức là quý vị ăn lấy Chúa Giêsu và uống lấy huyết của Ngài để được kết nối với Chúa, có sự sống với Chúa Giêsu, được tương giao với Đức Chúa Trời, được làm con cái của Chúa Trời, thì xin mời quý vị đến với bàn tiệc này. Nếu quý vị chưa có đức tin, và nếu quý vị muốn bày tỏ đức tin của mình qua vấn đề dự tiệc thánh sáng hôm nay, thì xin mời quý vị cùng chúng tôi dự tiệc thánh để bày tỏ nên niềm tin của quý vị ở nơi Chúa. Và sau đó xin quý vị liên lạc với chúng tôi để chúng tôi có thể giúp quý vị làm lễ tắp tem để xác chứng lên niềm tin của mình ở nơi Chúa. Tôi xin tin đọc lời của Chúa ở trong Sơ Corinto thứ nhất. Vì tôi cứ nhận nơi Chúa điều tôi đã dạy cho anh em, hay là trong đêm Chúa là Đức Chúa Giêsu bị phản nộp, Ngài lấy bánh tạ ơn, bẻ ra và phán rằng: này là thân thể ta vì các con mà phó cho, hãy làm điều này để nhớ ta. Cùng một cách đấy, sau khi ăn bữa tối rồi, Ngài lấy chén và phán rằng: chén này là giao ước mới trong huyết ta, hãy khi nào các con uống, hãy làm điều này để nhớ ta. Vậy mỗi lần anh em ăn bánh này, uống chén này, thì rao giảng sự chết của Chúa cho đến lúc Ngài đến. Vì thế, nếu ai ăn bánh, uống chén của Chúa một cách không xứng đáng thì sẽ mắc tội với thân và huyết của Chúa. Vậy, mỗi người phải tự xét lấy mình, rồi mới ăn bánh, uống chén ấy. Vì người nào không phân biệt thân Chúa mà ăn bánh, uống chén, tức là ăn uống sự phán xét cho chính mình. Vì lý do đó mà trong anh em có nhiều người đau yếu, bệnh tật và có lắm kẻ ngủ. Nếu chúng ta tự xét mình, thì sẽ không bị phán xét. Nhưng khi Chúa phán xét, Ngài sửa phạt để chúng ta không bị kết án chung.
He will correct us so that we will not be as judged as the world. So let us come to the Lord at this time and examine our hearts. If the Lord, if the Lord speaks to your heart about any sins, then we need to confess our sins before the Lord. And if we have any conflicts with others, we need to resolve it before coming to this table so that we will have the right relationship with God as we come to this communion table.
Thank you. One final breath and it was finished. Welcome everybody back from Risen Sunday, and we're back here, and we will have prayer time at this time. Today, Pastor Min will be sharing the word. I will not be sharing the word. Well, thank you. I take it as a good thing. So any prayer requests amongst us? We have several people who are sick. I praise the Lord that we went through Risen Sunday with nobody sick, right? And I mean, yes, I'm so sorry. I meant the people who were singers, choir.
Oh, okay.
And I praise the Lord that is a one-man show back there with Anthony, but thank you, Marlon and David, I think, for helping out when I asked to help out. And Noah, yes. So thank you, y'all, for pulling in when we need it, because the crew, Anthony's crew, was sick, right? So praise the Lord that Trenton and Justin are both better now and they're back. But after the Risen Sunday service, we have several people sick. Like Anthony lost his voice. Timothy, you got sick too. And Daniel now, and Kung Wik, and several people are sick.
Wow.
So we praise the Lord for that. Just like for the Christmas program, everybody was fine. And then afterwards, I lost my voice. I got sick. And I think other people got sick too. So praise the Lord that we make it through these big events with nobody really that is, you know, in the choir that is sick. So let's pray for everyone, especially for, we praise the Lord that Lily's brother was able to hear the word after the service and he came to know the Lord. So he placed his faith in him, in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so please pray for Ting. I think that's an American name, right?
Kyle.
Okay. Pray for him that he will grow in the faith. And for Lily, Lily's very busy, but hopefully she can make time to come to worship the Lord. And so pray for Gam Yom, Ba Jung, Lily, and hopefully Ting will study the baptism class, that they will be able to grow in the faith, firm in the faith, and be baptized. So let us come to the Lord in prayer at this time. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you have given to us. Thank you for the beautiful days that you have given to us the past few days. We thank you that you are Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you that from heaven, you left your throne to come down to this earth because you so loved us and you want to bring us close to you as well as to be saved from our sins. So thank you, Lord Jesus, for your sacrifice on the cross. What a beautiful, beautiful love that you have shown on that cross. And then you died, but 3 days later you rose from the dead. You walked out of the grave. And so we thank you, Lord, that you are the living God that we are worshiping and serving. We praise you for all your blessings upon our lives. We thank you for the Risen Sunday and that you have blessed it and everything went well. We have visitors who came. And Lord, your word has been spoken. So I pray that you will touch their hearts, that they will come to faith soon. I pray that you'll be especially with Ting. Thank you so much for opening his eyes and heart to you. I pray that you will help him to grow in the faith. Father God, I pray that your Holy Spirit will dwell in him, make him a new creation in you. And Lord, help him and Lily and Gam Yom and Ba Jung that they will be able to study, go through the baptism class and be baptized. And Lord, I also thank you for your blessing upon us, those who have been ill, who have been touched by you and restored. Thank you that Trenton and Justin are better and they're back to worship. I also pray that you'll be with those who are ill at this time, has a cold and are trying to fight it. I pray that you help them to overcome it soon. I pray that you touch Kung Wik, Daniel, Timothy, and others who may be sick. Father, I pray that you'll be with those who are bedridden or sick for a while. I pray your touch upon them. And amongst them are Ba Hua. She is not doing well. I pray you touch her. I pray you touch Om Lap as he continues to be on his sick bed, Lord. Whatever your will is for his life, Father, we pray that you will have mercy upon this family. And Lord, I pray that you'll be able to, that you will, in your will, take him home to be with you so that he will no longer suffer and that the family will have the strength during this time to care for him. I pray that you'll be with our church. Bless us, each one of us, Lord, in our daily life, that we walk with you, that we will be victorious over sin, and that we will draw close to you each and every day. Help us to study your word and to love your word. Help us to memorize your word, and that we will have your word in our hearts so that we will not sin against you. Father, I pray that you'll be with the family camp that's coming up in May. I pray your blessing upon it. I pray you'll be with the English EM speaker as well as the Vietnamese speakers. I pray that you bless everyone, that we will have a blessed camp. I also pray that you'll be with Lake Swan Camp that's coming up in July, as well as the district conference in end of June. And I pray your blessing upon those who need your guidance and help in school, as well as in their work. Lord, at this time, I pray your blessing upon Mopsu Min, anoint him as he gives the word, that you will speak to our hearts through him. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen. Is that Pastor Min praying over there?
I think so.
That's why he's not here. Okay. Well, any testimonies while we wait for him? Interesting. Okay. No testimonies? I'm sorry that your camp is moved back sometime, right? Because there is no availability of the campsite. The tent camp that you guys were going to have. West Palm or something like that, right? Peanut Island. Yes, so the next 3 months it is booked, so we will not be able to do that. But hey, we can still have fun, right? Now, in two more weeks, the women's group here in church, we wanted to have more picnics than just a Thanksgiving picnic. Every year just to have one picnic. So we decided to have another picnic, and it's going to be at the beach, the pavilion that we have been there at Thanksgiving about 2 or 3 years ago. So we will have that on Sunday, the 21st, April 21st. And so bring along whatever you want to bring along. And we will, after Sunday school, we're allowed to get out there because I already booked the pavilion. It's ours the whole day. So it's just fun time out there. So be prepared for that. Anything else except that for Lake Swan Camp, ours truly, Kathy, and whoever else will lead the singing, the worship. And David, Kathy, and Caitlin, whoever can go, will be part of the praise band. We will lead worship for Lake Swan. So, any other prayer requests? Testimonies, I mean? Or prayer requests, if you'd like to. How many of you are studying the passage in Jude?
I'm sorry?
Oh, Marlon, yes. How many of you are studying Jude? I hope so. Go for it. Study it. Memorize it, okay? Vietnamese, English, Spanish, whatever you like. Just memorize God's word. Okay. Any testimonies in the week? If you have, God has spoken to you about anything, or through devotion. I hope you do have devotion. Walk with the Lord every day. Very important. Encourage one another in that too. Okay. I don't know what his message is, so I don't know. Is there anything else? Let's read Jude together. Let's take this opportunity. Jude, you guys are learning in NIV? Yes, NIV Jude. Jude. It's like Jude, Jude. Only one chapter, right? Yes, but the book only has one chapter. Did you guys know that? Yes, okay. All right, let's read it together. But, hi, but. You guys got it? This is a call to persevere. You don't give up. We hold on to the finish line. Watch this. Oh, Marlon. Marlon, how far have you gone?
We're all 19.
Yeah, we're all studying together. Very good. Excellent. Let's read it together. But, dear friends, remember what the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ foretold. They say to you, in the last times, there will be scoffers who will follow their own ungodly desires. These are the people who divide you, who follow mere natural instincts and do not have the Spirit. But you, dear friends, by building yourselves up in your most holy faith and praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in God's love as you wait for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ to bring you to eternal life. Be merciful to those who doubt. Save others by snatching them from the fire. To others show mercy, mixed with fear, hating even the clothing stained by corrupted flesh. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forever. Amen. All right. That's a great passage for this time, this day and age, as we have to face a lot of things in life. And just be careful as you go. You might go places and you get involved in some churches. No, look into it. Research the church, what their beliefs are, because there's a lot of false prophets right now in the churches. And there's a lot of divisions in the churches. I heard on Friday night Zoom meeting that we have a lot of Vietnamese from Vietnam joining us and all that. And they're sharing that in Vietnam right now, there's a lot of division in the churches. We have to be careful because the devil is at work. Mok Siu Minh, welcome back.
Yes, I'm sorry for being tardy.
What shall we do for tardiness?
Yeah, exactly. You reward with a lot of good food.
Am I to turn this off so it doesn't follow me? Yes? Okay. Mok Siu Minh will come to us, and okay. So your time is cut a little short because of your prayer.
Yeah, I know, because of my long prayer, now will be my long message, so you get used to it, so that's a good thing. What is it?
I had to get this to focus on him, or else it's going to follow me.
Oh. Oh, it can follow me too?
No, yes, it's
following you now.
Oh.
So if you walk out here, it'll turn.
But you have to turn face. You have to face
the
camera.
Oh, I like that.
But then I don't know if it's 360 though.
It is.
Oh, is it not?
But you have to keep looking at the camera.
It always points that way when you leave.
That's true.
Oh, you have to look at it in order for it to follow you?
Yeah.
Oh, sound like you guys good. We have to keep our eyes on you. For you to, okay. To know that we follow you. Okay, good. All right, here you go. Let me see. Couldn't turn on the camera. All right, no problem. Okay. It should be set up, right? So how's everybody doing?
Wonderful.
Wonderful. Wow. Happy birthday, Marlon.
Happy birthday, Marlon.
Wow. Yeah, I did pray for you in the main church for happy birthday, for your blessings on birthday, right? What's going on here? Oh my goodness. Okay. I hope it, you know what? It's all set up, ready to go. And I had to turn, didn't turn up, but you know, I just put my laptop to sleep. And now it doesn't get going. So hopefully Anthony will come to my rescue, because that is beyond me.
He's talking to Anthony.
Okay, good. All right. Thank you very much. Okay, guys. I know you're dying to get me back. I at least fancy thinking that way. But whether you look back, you look forward to being back or not, I want to thank you for praying for me. It's amazing how God intervene just at not just the right time, but I think the exact moment when I need to leave here for Toronto, leave Toronto for Charlotte, and then leave Charlotte for here. But especially the trip back to Toronto for my son with my mom so sick here, you know, and then it's still in the hospital. And then my son had been in the hospital. You know, he remember Huey, right? I mean, he was in the hospital for only 1 week long. And it wasn't too bad. I mean, it was severe, but it was getting better. And in fact, he said he will be discharged in 2 days. And I said, wow, I don't need to come there because Mom Ba Noi need me here more. And he said, yeah, stay there. But then my brother said, no, you go. I came from San Jose, California for you to go. So go, whether he's in the hospital or he's discharged in 2 days and stay home, you want to spend time with him, please go. And therefore I went. Little did I know, I took the flight. I landed in Pearson Airport. I took the train straight to the hospital. I spent the first night with him in the hospital. And from there, I spent the next 2 weeks with him in the hospital. Because the night I came back to him, he suddenly felt acute pain in his abdomen, like never before. And that being the case, I mean, he was in excruciating pain. I thought he's not going to be able to make it through this. I mean, the way he cried out and screamed. And then I realized that his abdomen infected. And they said there's a hole in his intestine that caused infection because the air filled his abdomen. And they said, the CT scan showed that clearly and we have to operate on him. But when we open it up, we have to still kind of like search to see where the hole is and then patch it together. And that's a major one. It will be a major mess up. But while they were waiting for the radiologist to take one final look at the CT scan image, they realized that it may not be the case. So they were willing to wait it out. And lo and behold, it wasn't the hole at all. So he was spared that surgery. Anyway, to make a long story short, after a period of 4 weeks in the hospital, he's discharged and he's back home and now running to hemo, but still in need of a kidney transplant. So would you please pray so that he will get that and will be more long-term stability for Hubert, okay? So keep him in prayer. Thank you so much. But anyway, I had a good time in Charlotte. Never realized I could preach there because I had no idea down here and up there in Toronto, both a sick grandma as well as Hubert. But finally, both were okay enough for me to travel. And so I was down in Charlotte, and what a beautiful church, just like ours, same size. A lot of young people like us here, and that's a lot of hope. I want to go back to Easter and particularly to Good Friday and to share with you a word of hope, because I believe in our lives there's nothing better than a word of hope in a time of need. At any time, really, you want cheerful news, you want hope. But especially in critical time like my mom's sickness and Hubert's sickness and so on and so forth, you want to hear a word of hope. And you want to bring into those situations a word of hope, because often you don't know what to pray for when you visit them in the hospital. And then when you go to, if they pass away, they go to their funeral, and you don't want, you don't want to say the wrong thing. You don't want to write something in the card that doesn't make sense. And you feel like your words are so inadequate and you need something, you know, more touching, more powerful, more spirit-filled. And so what do you say in those situations? Whether it's the word that you express to the one dying or their last words to you, I believe last words carry a lot of weight. Last words are very important, very significant, and I may say last words are very revealing. Because whatever you choose to say in your last breath means a lot to you, right? It must be the most important thing in your life, right? That you want to leave with those you loved. And therefore, they are very revealing. Revealing the, what your major concerns and what your hope happen to be. And when people in terminal situation, it is very difficult for the doctors or the nurses to let them know that, you know, their time is almost over. Okay. All right. I don't know why that is the case, but anyway. Thank you so much, Anthony. Appreciate that, man. And so very difficult to speak with the dying, especially about the bad news that they are going to pass away. And therefore, it's best to remain silent. But you see, this is in contrast to what Jesus did on the cross. Because, I'm sure you know about this, because Jesus, in his dying moments, suffering like to the extremes on that cross, he did say a few words that meant a lot. He actually leave us with a lot of words. We will go into it, but let's see some other people, famous, popular guys and gals who have left some of their last words. I don't know if you like film Shaq Lo. I mean, coi film Shaq Lo, huh? Yeah. Oh man, I grew up with that. I love it. I never had enough of it. But anyway, Charlie Chaplin, in that series, said this. When he was dying, finally, he said this after a priest already reading to him his last rite. And the priest said, "May the Lord have mercy on your soul." And reportedly, Charlie Chaplin retorted and said, "Well, after all, you know, why not? Because it all belongs to him anyway. So, you know, my soul or whatever, right?" One of the greatest English statements, Prime Minister, is Winston Churchill. In World War II, he was one very, very famous because he brought the British Army to victory over Hitler in World War II very well. And he said it before slipping into a coma and dying 9 days later. I'm so bored with it all. I don't know what he meant, but he has seen so much, especially the war and everything, you know, the struggle and the Mickey Mouse stuff that seemed to be going between people. He said, "I'm really bored with life as I see it." Beethoven, I mean, he is one of those geniuses. I mean, this guy, when he was only 4 or 5, he only played both the piano and the violin and composed music. It's just amazing. And it took him like an hour to learn a new piece and play masterfully and play flawlessly at 8-5. All right? So his symphony number 5 or even number 9, I mean, he was drawing his last breath and yet he was composing symphony number 9, for example. I mean, one of those masterpieces. Anyway, he said this, "Applaud, my friends, the comedy is finished." I mean, this guy has a sense of humor. He looked at life as a comedy, and now it is drawn to an end for him. Mozart, equally famous like Beethoven, he said, "You know what? I'm tasting death. I'm tasting death right now. I feel something that is out of this earth." It's just incredible for him. This guy, Leonardo da Vinci, you know, one of those, some of those very popular, famous paintings, especially Holy Communion that Jesus Christ with the 12 disciples. That's a beautiful picture. And the Mona Lisa, I mean, those paintings are like international acclaim, right? But Leonardo da Vinci said, "You know, after all that work, I feel I have offended both God and man. Why? Because in the end, my work have not reached the quality that they should have reached." Very dissatisfied with his kind of like perfection. All right? Thomas Hope, I am about to take my last voyage. I hope we never have to say this. A great leap in the dark. Blaise Pascal said, faith is the leap in the dark. He's very popular for that. But if you're dying and you're feeling you are only taking a leap into the dark, I mean, God has mercy on your souls. Is it going to be a leap in the dark? Or is it going to be a leap into the light? You sure?
Yes.
You know, one of the greatest blessings for us to go on evangelism, meaning sharing faith with others, like Cô Hương sharing faith with Bảo Trân or Cẩm Nhung, and led them to Christ. And the joy that I have and some of you may have as well is, you know, to shake their hands and say, now that you have Jesus Christ, if you were to take your last breath, if you go to bed tonight, you close your eyes, you sleep, and you never open, you never wake up again from this sleep, where are you going to open your eyes at or in? And they say, heaven. Oh man, what a security, what an assurance. Amen? That's the greatest joy, right? I mean, the greatest news that you, and greatest assurance that you can bring to someone dying is the assurance, I mean, no doubt, I can, based on the word, the promise of God, especially on the teaching of the pastor on the lessons today, I can assure you that you will be in paradise. Man, nothing can bring you hope more than that, right? That is the best hope you can ever bring. I mean, the greatest insurance, the greatest security. So now live in the dark. Oh, surprise, my God, what has happened? Like Princess Diana, but died heroically, like Top Beamer on the event of September 11, some 23 years ago. Let's roam. That's wrong, guys. That's wrong. And Karl Marx, communism, you know? But he said that, I don't care about living my last word, because only those who have not said enough need to say some more in order for the world to remember. You know, some of us may say, I wish you had spoken less or written less. The world would have been much better. So last word can be very revealing, and my question to you is, what would you say in your dying moment? Can you say something like, this great British preacher by the name of Charles Spurgeon said, Jesus died for me? Or John Wesley, one of the greatest evangelists, founder of the Methodist Church, the best of all is this, God is with us. And that's all that really matters. Jesus left us the last seven words on the cross. Can you name them? My Father, forgive them, for they know what they do not know what they are doing. And number two, today you be with me in paradise. And number three, not yet. Mother, woman, here's your son. Son, this is your mom now. He said that to Mary, the mother, and to the Apostle John. And then lastly, the last one will say for himself, I thirst. And then he said, my God, why are you forsaking me? And then he said, all has been accomplished. Tetelestai, mọi sự đã được chọn ha. All is done, completed. My work on earth is done. And then finally he said, Father, into your soul I commit my spirit. Into your hands I commit my spirit. And so you can see those seven words, but we're going to focus on the first two because they are relevant to what we want to be assured of today. And that is, he said to the thief, today you'll be with me in paradise. In paradise. You see? To me, his last words reveal heaven to us. Reveal not just his soul, his inner being, what he's most concerned about, but revealing even heaven, even eternity to us, especially in this sand to the penitent so-called thief, right? The guy who repented in his dying moment, and he assured, today you will be in paradise. That means Christ opened heaven for us to see for the first time as never before. So we focus on those, and let's quickly go through this. We're going to read it together, if you don't mind, right? There were also two others, criminals, led with him to be put to death. And when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. And they divided his garments and cast lots. And the people took looking on. But even the rulers with them sneered, saying, he saved others, let him save himself. If he is the Christ, the chosen of God. The soldiers also mocked him, coming and offering him sour wine, and saying, if you are the king of the Jews, save yourself. And an inscription was also written over him in letters of Greek, Latin, and Hebrew. This is the king of the Jews. Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, if you are the Christ, save yourself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? All right. You don't want to read that, but. So, as difficult as it is to say something to the one who is dying and you want to remain silent, Jesus happened to be in that situation. What situation? He was crucified. And where was he crucified? On a hill, Golgotha, but in what position? There are three crosses. Where was he? In the middle. Why in the middle? Was he such a notorious guy that they need to kind of like highlight him so that others can see clearly? Is it? Actually, the Romans, even Pilate, you know, Pontius Pilate, the governor said, I found nothing wrong with this guy. Why do you guys want me to crucify him, to execute him? You know what I mean? So even the Romans recognize that he is not such a notorious criminal to deal with, right? And yet they place him in the middle. Maybe just by mistake, maybe unintentionally, but they never realized that that was fulfilling the prophecy by Isaiah, all the way in chapter 53, 700 years before that, when Isaiah the prophet said that he would be numbered among the transgressors. That means he's counted. He is considered one of the criminals. He is one of the criminals. See that? So whether they like it or not, they were doing that. And they placed the most holy guy, the most holy man ever lived on earth, to die right in the middle of all the ungodly, unholy people. And that is, I believe, the heart of the gospel. You see, most of us think of God being so highly and lifted up, so lofty, so far away. On the contrary, God is very close to us. When Jesus Christ, when his son came into earth, with the mission to die for us, he wasn't born in a castle. Where was he born? Among the cattle, not castle, cattle, remember that? I mean, he came so low down to be with us, the lowest people on earth, right? The most downtrodden people will feel him being close. And not just as his birth, but even as his death. He wasn't number among the rich and the powerful. You know, one thing I noticed very important, if you ever go to Charlotte, North Carolina, make sure you drop by the Billy Graham Center. This guy is world renowned, right? I'm glad we have an evangelist that doesn't get, I mean, he probably gets that too, but not often the ridicule, the look down, the criticism, everything else. And he was among kings and queens. You know how many presidents have come to his home? And how many presidents were present at his funeral? Three of the presidents that are still living were there for his funeral. With two or three days of long line of people and long cars line up to bid farewell to him. And among the kings and queens like that, his coffin, guys, remember, listen to me carefully, his coffin cost only $2,000 or less. A lot of people would like put money into the most evious pieces of furniture of all things at funeral is the casket. And yet, carried by the National Guard of Honor on the steps of Washington, D.C., capital city, it is poor coffin. So exemplary of Christ. Follow in Christ's step. Died like a criminal and died among the ridicules and everything else. But that is the way that Jesus came to us. He descended so that through his descension we might ascend to the newness of life with him. Anyway, we want to hear in particular what all this means. So let's look at three points I want to highlight for you. I'm going to invite you to look at his fear of God. And then I'm going to invite you to look at his faith in God. And how he made the transition from fear to faith and therefore decide his own future by such decision. So, from fear to faith to future, we are going to focus first of all on how he showed his fear for God. In the story that we just read, verse 40 of Luke 23, in the midst of all the ridicule, including that of his fellow criminal on the other side of Jesus Christ in the middle, and this guy was also kind of like ridiculing Jesus, there's nothing else good to say about him. And this thief looked at the other guy and said, "Hey guy, I know you're my friend, but listen, man. I mean, we are dying. We are being executed justly, right? I mean, we deserve to die." But not this guy. Have you ever seen him before? Did he belong to any gang? None. So, don't you fear God in your heart? Why are you persecuting him with your merciless critique like that? And so he rebuked his friend. But in that rebuke, he showed his fear for God. And it's all the more astonishing because this guy who rebuked the other friend, kind of like, yeah, what do you get to, what do you gain really? You know, trying to rebuke your friend last minute? After all, I mean, he and you deserve to die and die forever. So what's the point? You're trying to score some point or what? What for? You're trying to gain a favor? What kind of favor are you looking for at this moment anyway? So hopeless, come on, man. He was out of his options. There's no more option for him. The only option left is die. Yes, take your last breath and then go to hell forever. You see, scum, the earth is no longer considering you worthy to live on it. You don't deserve to even stay on earth. Your only place is hell. And that's final, man. His options are out. If he wants for a new beginning to turn new leaf, oh man, it's too late for that. There's no more time for you to do anything good. Come on, don't fool yourself. And so he's been very hopeless. But out of that fear was born his faith. In fact, if we don't fear God, we could never have faith. It's good that we have a sense of fear of reverence for God. We learned this in our Sunday school, right, Timothy? Yeah? How do you define fear God? The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom and so on and so forth. But fear really means you revere, you show your reverence, your honor to God, for God. And so out of fear, and we need to start with fear. Until people realize God is such a fearful God, meaning you should fear before him, you will not run to him. You will not run away from sin. You will rather run into all those lucrative deals that you may have in life. You may yield to temptation because they are more inviting, more tempting. But why don't we do that? Why aren't we running ahead foolishly, eternally dead into those things? Because of the fear of God in our heart. Remember, even the devil fear God. But unless fear give birth to faith, you will just be like the devils. You're dying. There's nothing can turn you around. But fear can lead you to faith because you realize there's nothing else for you. There's nothing else besides faith in the grace of God, in his love. All right? So this guy came up with a strong faith in Jesus. How do I know that? How do I know that? Because he said, because in his prayer, remember? He said, remember me when you come into your kingdom. That is the only thing. I mean, beside the rebuke, he laid on his friend because of the ridicule, he now confessed his own faith. His faith was shown in that rebuke, but more clearly in his the only request to the dying Christ, right? And that is to remember me. You've been there. I was there. I was young, I was single. I was lonely, and I go to camp, hoping to find someone, right? And when I find someone that take my heart, how do I approach her? I mean, at that time, no text or whatever, so hoping you can get her phone number or something like that, just a phone number, that's all you have, really. And what else do you say, you know? All you can say is, just remember me, right? And you hope that at least to be remembered, nothing else, right? Because that would be a good start, right? And this guy just prayed to Jesus, dying on the cross himself. Oh, please, when you go into your kingdom, please remember me. He dare not ask for anything more than that. Just to be remembered. And that's all we need. Because, you know, he's going to be forgotten very quickly, very soon. In fact, the whole world, including his friends, and not just friends, but family, would rather forget him. Such a scum. You bring dishonor, you bring shame to our family. You criminals, you robbers. we would rather not have you, or at least now not to have to remember you. So he's going to be soon forgotten, as most of us may be and will be someday. But you know, it is important for others to remember you. My dad passed away into God's glory, and he often said, you know what, no tomb for me, no tombstone, nothing, just scatter my ash out on the sea somewhere. I don't need anyone to bother to come to visit me, and so on and so forth. And that's his wish, but we have different wish. We want to hang on to his memory, right? So we establish all that contrary to his desire. But you see, but some others build monuments, big, huge, like I said, you know, contrary to that poor coffin that Abraham had, right? Because they want to be remembered by their friends and by the whole world, shining as ever, right? But this guy knows, at that time, in eternity, it doesn't really matter how many people remember you, but whether God remembers you or not. Amen? But that's the only thing that really counts for eternity, right? So he asked that something very, very simple. All the more astonishing if you think of this. Number one, he never knew Jesus before that. He never knew Jesus. Never heard of Jesus' fame, the good name and the good deed that Jesus was bringing into his own life, making a name for himself. So popular. The guy didn't know that, because he didn't know that, and therefore he ridiculed. I mean, at first he joined in with the other guys to ridicule Christ, right? Right? Mercilessly, right? 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 Yeah. So that's so he didn't know Jesus. So he encountered Jesus for the first time on the cross. His only chance, his one and only last chance. And yet he yielded right away. And all the more the worthy of notice, because he found this savior, this guy, hope in him, in a place that one of the most unlikely places, on Golgotha. That's where you fight criminals. You don't fight the Messiah. You don't fight Christ. And therefore, it's all the more. So my question to you is, what changed his mind? What changed this thief's mind about the guy in the middle, on the middle cross? Why? Why did he change his mind? I believe there are a few things, and this is good for us to go to Bible study, to read the Word of God, because first of all, he heard something from the mouth of Jesus. It's just a prayer, but it's the Word of God. When Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know what they are, not what they are doing," and so that impressed him, because number one, Jesus was calling God his Father. A lot of people would take the name of God and swear in their dying moments, in their excruciating suffering and pain. But this guy called God Father, not swearing God, but my Father. And he asked for forgiveness for his enemy, not retaliation, but forgiveness. And he even argued on his behalf, on their behalf, being the lawyer defending them. Oh, they don't know what they're doing, so never mind. And then number two, he heard even from others in their ridicule. They were blaspheming, they were malicing him, but yet in their words, when they challenge Jesus to save himself and then to save them as well, there is the word salvation. There was the word save, and therefore it rings a bell. Oh man, if this guy can save, I need him. Amen? So it's very good to hear the word of God. Even from the enemies, yeah. Even Pilate, when he put that sign on the cross, you know, that banner, it said, the King of the Jews. It turned out to be, I call it the gospel tract. That means someone to proclaim the good news of God. This is the King. They will really kill him with that, but it means something else to this thief. It means, well, man, he's the King. And that's why in his prayer, he didn't mention Jesus as King, but indirectly he said, when you come into your kingdom, then remember me. That means he already, at least indirectly, acknowledged the kingship of Jesus Christ. You never know what God can turn around sometimes to turn people to him, all right? And especially when this Messiah was dying himself. I mean, he could hardly save himself, and yet this thief expressed faith in him. I mean, I find that incredible as well. He didn't wipe out these Romans legions as he should have. And all the more astonishing because the thief that repents have not seen anything spectacular yet. The darkness never came yet, right? It came only when Jesus took his last breath, right? Are you looking for the total eclipse, totality tomorrow? It should be. We don't have it here. But if you live in Dallas, Texas, or you live in Toronto, Canada, you know Niagara Falls? Niagara Falls is the place where it's total, going to be 99% dark at least, right? So, totality. 1 million people will descend on the cloud of Niagara Falls, little Niagara Falls, tomorrow. 1 million people. But anyway, the darkness has not come. The earthquake has not happened. The veil in the temple has not been torn in two. Christ has not been resurrected from the dead and ascended into heaven. He never seen, maybe not even heard, that Jesus walking on water. He was feeding the multitude with just 5 loaves and 2 fish. He turned the water into wine and everything else. You see, all that not happened, and yet he expressed his faith in Jesus. And so, at a time when Christ was so helpless to save anyone, Christ appeared to him like that. And he placed his faith in Christ. And he said, oh, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Amen? So, his faith and therefore lead to his future. Jesus responded with just one promise. Today, you shall be with me in paradise. Remember, you will be in paradise. Wow, that simple, eh? That quick? You mean, wait a minute. I thought when you died is the end. Annihilated, you're gone forever. Nothing else, right? So why you say that after I die, I go somewhere else, even paradise? I don't care. Nothing left for me. You decide so, but not God, right? And you mean you don't have to go through purgatory? You know, like a halfway kind of house, you know? You go there first to get really cleaned up, and then you go to heaven, right? That's what the other churches may be teaching, but not our church, right? No intermediate step like that. No. You go straight to heaven. You get straight to paradise. You don't pray to Mary either. I mean, Mary, the mother of Jesus, was standing at the cross in need of salvation herself. So you don't pray to her like other churches may be teaching you. So he assured this guy that he will be in paradise. And not tomorrow, not the next decade, but now, today, before the sun set, you'll be with me in paradise. Today. So today is the moment, guys, and today is the time for decision. If you have not decided to follow Christ, if you have not decided to receive his salvation, now is the day, because you don't want to miss it and you'll be in paradise. And so you don't have to wait for baptism either, and that doesn't mean you don't have to go through baptism, but you know, this guy never had a chance to do that. No last rite, but absolute assurance. And Jesus, in his dying moment, can control all of that. So I want to draw this to a conclusion. You see, both guys, both criminals on the sides of Jesus, they were both communicating with Christ. But one was ridiculing him, and the other was confessing his faith in him. One said, if you're the Christ, you save yourself, and then you save us as well. And what if Jesus had answered that guy's prayer, you know? I mean, he was ridiculing, but it's really a prayer, right? Please, save yourself, and then save us too. That's a prayer, right? And what if Jesus had answered that prayer and granted him his wish? Number one, Jesus would never die on the cross because he would save himself, right? And the whole world would be dying until now. And secondly, number two, even if that guy was saved from the cross and he lived on, what does he gain? A few more years? And then what?
Death.
Still dead, right? Right? Still dead. And dead forever, eternity, right? So, thank God that prayer was an answer. But the prayer, that was answer is the other prayer. And that prayer is really, you know, today remember me when you come to your kingdom. All right? When you come to your kingdom. And so, nothing else separating them, not because of their race, not because of their geography, not because they were so far away from Jesus. They both were very close. They both were in church, you might say, okay? But two different destinies, because one wasn't placing his faith in Christ and the others did, all right? So I want you to choose the right side to be on. Amen? Amen? Will you please stand with me? We're going to bow in a word of prayer. Father, Lord God, I want to thank you so much for coming to our salvation. And if the thief on the cross can find Christ so attractive, so worthy of his faith, oh Lord, help us to do all the more, because now that we have seen the miracles and heard about the miracles that Christ did, the wonderful teaching, his death on the cross, and especially his rise from the dead, his resurrection that we just celebrate at Easter, and all of that, help us place our faith in you and choose heaven rather than hell. And I believe that today is the day that you will pray that. So please pray with me and receive Christ for yourself. Let us sing together a song that I think will be very good for us to sing together. This world is not my home. I hope the sound will go on. Can you see the sound? Home night just in passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue.
Oh, yeah.
I cannot control that. No, I have no friend like you. If heaven not my home, the Lord, what will I do? Can you see that? Okay. All right, no problem. Can you hear now? I'm sorry for not having tested the voice, the sound. Now we are talking. Thank you. Miracles.
This world is
not my home. I'm just passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angel beckoned me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angel beckoned me from heaven's open door, and don't feel at home in this world anymore. Have a loving mind, pictures over in Glory Land. And I don't expect to stop until I shake his hand. She's waiting now for me in heaven's open door. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friends like you. If heaven not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angel beckoned me from heaven's open door. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. The last verse. Wow. Don't you want to dance? In the land, we'll live eternally. The saints on every hand are shouting victory. Their songs of sweetest praise drip back from heaven's shore. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Lord, you know I got no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then look, what will I do? The angel beckoned me from heaven's open door. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. How you feeling, guys? I'm not at home in this world anymore. All right, thank you so much. All right, let me pray blessings on you. Father, I commit my friends to you, all my friends in EM at South Florida Church, to you, into your love, into the love of God, into the grace of Jesus Christ, and into the holy communion of the Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name, amen.
Hope to see you
on Friday, right? We'll be back on Friday, right?
Yeah.
Please do your best to go back on Friday. It's very important to hear, Father, forgive them, and today you'll be in paradise with me, and that's been enough. Thank you. We'll hear from God again.